In the mBlock app, using the mobile device extension programming blocks, let's learn how to make this donut eating game. To make this game, we will use the blocks in mBlock, which are based on the accelerometer sensor of a mobile phone. And this allows us to control a sprite by tilting our phone up, down, left or right. So in this game, we have this panda, which we will control by tilting our phone, and the objective is to eat as many donuts as you can. Let us learn step by step how to make this game. First, let us learn how to move our panda sprite using the accelerometer sensor in our mobile phone. To do this, we have to first install an extension in mBlock. So you go to the bottom left and click this plus button to add extensions. And here you will see there are some very nice extensions which we will look at in later videos. But for now, the extension we are looking for is called blocks for mobile. And I'm going to add these blocks. So when we have this extension, mobile device blocks, we get these programming blocks when finger slides up or down. And if I click the drop down, I can see the options are up, down, left and right. We have another which is when phone is shaken. Another one which is called when phone is tilted up. And if you click the drop down, you will get all these options up, down, left and right. And when finger is pressed or when finger is released. So the one we are going to use right now is this one, when phone is tilted. So I'm going to delete the rest. I just wanted to show you the options. So what we are saying is when the phone is tilted up, we want the sprite to move up the Y axis. You will remember in another video I had explained that the stage of scratch is a coordinate plane in which you have across the horizon, you have the X axis and vertically you have the Y axis. The center point is 0, 0, and if you want to move a sprite up, basically you are increasing the on the Y axis, and if you want to move a sprite down, you are going to go into negative Y. And likewise, if you want to move a sprite to the right, you will go plus on the X axis, like plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4. And if you want to move a sprite to the left, you will go minus on the X axis. Minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, like that. So here what we are saying is when the phone is tilted up, we want the sprite to move up on the Y axis. So if I go here to motion blocks, in motion blocks, we have this command which says change X and change Y. So in this case, we want to change the Y by whatever value we want to put here. So let's say I put a value, a low value like 2. So I say okay, and then we can test the program. When I am tilting my phone up, my sprite is moving up. Then we can just duplicate this command and we can, from the drop down, we can select down. So now what we are saying is that when the phone is tilted down, we want that the Y coordinates of our sprite become negative. So what we are going to do here is we in change Y, we are simply going to say change Y by minus 2. So I hope you understand what we are doing here. We are saying when the phone is tilted up, as long as it is tilted up, keep changing the value of Y by 2. So our panda sprite will go up. And then we are saying when the phone is tilted down, change the value of Y by minus 2. So when we tilt the phone down, our panda sprite will keep coming down. Let's test this. As I tilt the phone down, the panda sprite comes down. And as I tilt the phone up, my panda sprite goes up. So now we have this smooth control of our sprite by tilting the phone. Now let's do the same thing to move our panda left and right. So again, I'm going to duplicate this command by just holding it. I'm going to duplicate it, and now I'm going to say when the phone is tilted left. And remember, when the phone is tilted left, that means on our stage, if this is 0, 0 coordinate, we want the x value to change, and we want the x value to be negative. So I'm going to delete this block, and I'm going to go back to motion, and from here I'm going to drag out change x, and I'm going to say change x by negative 2, and then I'm going to duplicate this, and I'm going to say when the phone is tilted right, which means we want that on the x axis now the value of x should change in a positive manner, so plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, like that. So I'm going to say change x by plus 2 or positive 2. So now let's test our program. When I tilt my phone up, my panda sprite moves up. When I tilt it down, it moves down. And when I tilt it left, it goes left. And when I tilt it right, it goes right. So now we've got the panda sprite, and we can control it by tilting our phone. We can of course add more effects to it. We can change the direction in which it is, the panda sprite is pointing. We can add the walking animation. But let us first make a simple game, and then we can add all these smaller elements to make the game more engaging later. So the next thing we want to do is we want to add a donut sprite, and then that donut sprite should appear at random places on our stage. You remember we had done this in the previous game, but this time we are going to do this a little different. So first I'm going to add a new sprite, and I'm going to go to food, and from food I'm going to choose this donut sprite, and then I'm going to first just make the donut small, because see the panda is this size and the donut is too big. So I'm going to go into parameters and then size, and I'm going to make the donut 40%. So now it looks better. Then what we want to do is we want the donut to appear at random places. So if you go into control blocks, and if you scroll down, mBlock has a very powerful command which says create a clone of myself. So create a clone of myself means that whatever sprite you put this on, it will make copies of itself. Clone means copy. So what we are going to say is when the green flag is clicked, create a clone of myself. So let's test this. If I click the green flag, it seems like nothing has happened, but actually there is one more donut which has appeared here. So if I move the donut, you will see that it has cloned. If I click the green flag again, it has cloned. So it is making a copy of itself. So what we want is we want a clone to be generated forever. So for this, we are going to go into the control blocks, and from here we are going to get a forever loop, and I'm going to put the create clone of myself in this forever block. But we don't want that the clone or the copy should forever get created at the same spot. We want it to get created and then move to random spots. So for this, if you scroll in control, if you scroll down, it has this other powerful command called when I start as a clone. So what we want is that when a clone is created, that clone should go to a random position. So for this, if you go to motion, you will remember this block from an earlier game we had made, and we can say go to a random position. So let's test our program. If I click the green flag, we have the clones of the donut sprite being created, and they are appearing on random positions. But what we want is that when it appears at a random position, that clone should disappear after some time, right? Because that's how we will make the game. So to do that, again in control, if you scroll down, there is this command called delete this clone. What I want is that when it starts as a clone, it should go to a random position. It should wait for, let's say, 1 second, and then that clone should get deleted. So let's test our program. So if I click the green flag, the clones are disappearing, but they are appearing at a faster rate than the rate at which they are disappearing. So to correct this problem, what we have to do is we have to put another wait here where the parent is being cloned. If you go back to control and you get a wait command, then I can say what we are saying here is that forever create a clone, then wait for 2 seconds, then create another clone, wait for 2 seconds, create another clone. And here what we are saying is as soon as a clone is created, take it to a random position. And in that random position, wait for 1 second and then delete that clone. So let's test this. If I click the green flag, now the clones of our parent donut are appearing at random positions and disappearing after 1 second, which is perfect, which is what we want for our game. The only thing is that we don't want this parent clone to be here. So for this, what you can do is, if you go to the donut sprite and you do go to editing, then you go to parameters and you just say hide the parent clone. So now what is happening is, if I click the green flag, actually nothing is happening because we have hidden the sprite. So what we have to do is we have to go back to our program. What is happening here is that we have hidden the parent sprite, which is what we want. But what we also want is that when the clone of that parent sprite is created, that should be visible. So because we have hidden the parent, even the clone is getting hidden. But to make it appear, then you go to looks blocks, and from here you drag out a show block, and you I'm going to put it after it goes to a random position. So what we are saying is that hide the parent, but when a clone is made, go to a random position, take that clone to a random position, and then show the clone, wait for 1 second, and then delete the clone. So let's see how this program is going to work. So now this is exactly what we want for our game. Our parent sprite is hidden, but when the clones are created, they appear on random positions and disappear after 1 second. And of course, if 1 second is too short a time, because you know we have to move the panda, right? We have to move the panda. When the clone comes, we have to take the panda there, and right now it's not, the clone is disappearing too fast. So to correct this, I'm going to increase the wait. So I'm going to increase the wait to 3 seconds, and I don't want the second clone to appear while the first clone is there. So I'm going to also make this 3 seconds. And now let's test the program. So now I have a chance of getting to the clone. I'm not very good at playing the game, but you can see that when a new clone appears, I'm able to take my panda by moving my phone, by tilting my phone, wherever the new clone is. So now this part is done. The last thing we want to do in the game is that when the panda touches the donut sprite, the sprite should disappear, because we are saying that the panda, if it touches the donut, the panda has eaten the donut. So to do this, we have to write a short program for what is called collision detection, when one sprite is touching another sprite. So what we want is that when the donut will start as a clone, we want to check the condition when it touches the panda sprite. So to do this, we will go to control, and from here we will again drag out another when I start as a clone, because that's the condition we want to check, that when the donut clone is there, then we want to detect a collision. So to detect a collision, we have to use what is called a conditional statement. A conditional statement is a if then statement, that if a condition is true, then do something. So I'm going to bring out this if then conditional statement. This is under the control blocks. I'm going to say when I start as a clone, and we want to check the condition. What is the condition? If the donut sprite is touching the panda sprite. So this, if you go into the sensing blocks from here, you can get this touching programming block, and if you click the drop down, there is the option mouse pointer, edge and any other sprite. So here we want the panda sprite. So what we are saying is, when the clone of the donut is touching the panda sprite, basically we just want to delete that clone also, right? Because that will be like the panda has eaten that donut. So I go back into control, scroll down, and I get the delete this clone sprite. Then I have to put this conditional statement into a forever loop, because if I don't put it into a forever loop, what will happen is, when the program will start, the first time the panda touches the donut, it will delete the donut clone, but then that condition is fulfilled once and this will never be checked again. But what we want is that this if then condition should be checked forever. So I'm going to go back into control and I'm going to get a forever loop, and I'm going to put this whole conditional statement inside the forever loop and then reattach it. So now let's test the game we have created. Whenever the panda touches the donut sprite gets deleted. And it really is getting deleted is something we can test. So if I stop the game, I go back and I'm going to remove this one. So what I'm testing is that it should not be that because of this command anyway the donut clone is getting deleted. The only reason why it is getting deleted is if the panda touches the donut. So let's test if our program is indeed working. So if I touch it, it disappears, but if I don't touch it, that clone is still there. That clone is still there because we have deleted that other command. And now when my panda will go and touch any one of this, then that clone will disappear. So this shows us that indeed the collision is being detected. So let me go back and attach this delete clone again, and now I restart the game, and now we have a game where we can control the panda sprite by moving, by tilting our phone, and anytime the panda touches the donut, the donut disappears, that is, it gets eaten. So this is the basic game. In the next video, I will show you how to improve this game, like add a score and, you know, add some special effects, sounds, etc. All that in the next episode.